everybody, I'm Tyler with More Flight Snail Trail 4x4 and NorCal 4x4 Rescue. We are here today with John Arnes, the one and only.
From Rubicon Trail Foundation.
And we're here to talk to you guys today about things to do to prepare for your trip coming up here to the Rubicon in the winter time. What are things going to do that's going to make your trip successful? We've got a bunch of other videos we've been doing and putting out there for everybody about recovery equipment, communications, gear to take with you. If you want to check those out, they're over at Rubicon Trail Foundation's YouTube page. Check them out. A lot of good information there. This video, though, is all about how to prepare for your trip. What are some things that we can do for that? So John here has done a lot of off-roading in his life, done a lot of snow wheeling in his life. Let's start with, I think, the vehicle, because the vehicle is something we're taking with us, right?
Sure.
What are some things we can do?
It's something we're taking with us, and it's going to take us with it.
Exactly. We're kind of like a symbiotic relationship that way.
Yeah.
What are some things we can do with the vehicle, check on it to prepare it, make sure it's ready for our trip?
Okay, so of course there's vehicle maintenance. I think that goes without saying, but now I just said it.
Yeah.
So too many people think annual maintenance is enough.
Mm-hmm.
You need to check, double check, and triple check, because this is your lifeline.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing with vehicle maintenance is nut and bolt check. People tend not to do that. If you have a lift, put on a lift. If you don't, get on a creeper and get underneath and make sure stuff's all tied together.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing about a nut and bolt check is you think that's what you're doing, but you find the other stuff, the cracks and
yes.
the damage, and oh, I didn't know that would look like that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I didn't know that was leaking. You find that when you get under there. So do that ahead of time.
Yep.
So
one tip that I know you do on your vehicle, a lot of people do on their vehicles, is paint pens.
To make
nut and bolt checks super easy. Explain that real quick for everybody.
So when you tighten, say, a jam nut on a tie rod end, if that jam nut once it's completely tight to spec, you can use a paint pen to draw a line from the tie rod end to the jam nut. If it moves, it's easy to see, because now the two lines are not lined up anymore.
Very quick
and
easy.
As soon as you see the bolt with no line or the line moved, mm-hmm. you know it's loose, and you know you got to tighten it up.
I like it. I think that is one of the quickest, easiest, simplest things you can do to quickly look over your vehicle and make sure that it is prepped and ready. But I love the idea of crawling under and really checking everything, because that is how you catch the other stuff.
Yep, that's how you catch the bad stuff.
I like it. What about a fuel? Obviously, we're in a vehicle that uses some sort of fuel.
Mm-hmm.
How much fuel do you take with you? When do you fuel up? What's your thought process there?
So I have a personal policy of leaving the trailhead with a full tank every time I wheel, whether I'm in snow or not.
Yeah.
This has a 26-gallon fuel cell in the middle of the vehicle, and it has a 6-cylinder motor that doesn't drink a lot of fuel, so that's enough. On dry ground, I've been Loon Lake to Tahoma to Spider to RTF Loop to Spider to Rubicon Springs to Loon Lake on a tank of fuel.
Wow.
So that's a lot.
That's a lot.
So that, in snow wheeling parlance, that you're going to use a lot more when you're snow wheeling, because you have more wheel speed that doesn't move you forward.
Mm-hmm.
So it's still a lot. I don't carry extra fuel, except for my 2-stroke fuel for my saw, which I always carry. So
mm-hmm.
that's an extra gallon.
Mm-hmm.
And that's synthetic, by the way, so it'll last a couple of years.
Okay.
So that way, if I do need to use it and it's been sitting on the tailgate a while, it's still perfectly good.
Uh-huh.
And the other thing I do is I fuel my tow rig to the top. So if it becomes part of my exit strategy,
mm-hmm.
in other words, if I have to walk out in snowshoes and stay in my tow rig for 2 days, to stay
use
warm,
it as shelter, as
use
warmth,
it
yeah.
as a shelter, it'll run that whole time and run yeah. a heater that whole time.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not going to run 24/7, but I'll have enough fuel to run it for 2 or 3 days and stay warm.
Yeah. I like that a lot. Fueling up at the very last spot you absolutely can before hitting the trail.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a big proponent of that for two reasons. A, you get the most fuel.
More is better.
More is better on the trail. I've been wheeling with a few people during snow wheeling where we're only halfway through the day and they're like, I'm almost out of fuel. I'm like, where did you fuel up? They're like, I fueled up yesterday or the day before.
Yesterday
I'm like,
in Orangevale.
What are you doing?
No, that doesn't work.
Yeah. So coming up here, I'm a big proponent of that for that reason. And the other reason is you get up here and you support the communities that are closest to the trail. And those communities are going to be our biggest supporters if we have any issues with the trail.
That's right.
So
never thought of it that way, but it's a great way to think.
Local economies, filling up your fuel. It may be more expensive up here in the mountains, but you're supporting those local communities and showing them that off-roaders are supporting their economy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a big fan of that. So cool. Fuel, I carry an extra gas can with me, 5 gallons, and it seems to work out great for me. You've got a 26-gallon tank. That's awesome. Mine's only 14 gallons. So yeah, I think that's a great point.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, from what else can we do with our vehicle to make sure that it's good and functioning well for snow wheeling? I think a big one is the cooling system of the engines.
Okay. Because
there's a lot of times when you're off-roading and snow wheeling that your grill and your radiator gets packed full of snow.
Yep.
And you see a lot of vehicles start to overheat in snow wheeling because we're using more wheel spin and we're not getting airflow over the radiator. So
yeah, people don't realize that. People think of snow wheeling as being nice and cool out, mm-hmm. and you're moving along. They don't realize how hard it is on a vehicle. Snow mm-hmm. wheeling is way harder on your vehicle than rock crawling.
Yes. Yep.
The general rock crawling.
Yeah. Yeah. So make sure your cooling system is up to par,
mm-hmm.
and that you're getting out and checking your front your radiator every once in a while. Let's see, what other things can we do to prepare for a trip?
So we talked about this in the communications episode, but I want to talk about it here too.
Okay.
When you're at home preparing for your trip, mentally put together a schedule for your trip. Know when you're going in, where you're going in, when you're coming out, where you're going out, and tell that to somebody in the world.
Yeah.
So they know to look for you and where to look for you.
Yep. I like that. Telling somebody, yeah, cheap form of insurance. It's free.
Cheap form of insurance.
And very effective if you tell the right person, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So
the other planning piece that we talked about communication.
Mm-hmm.
We had a whole episode on communication, right?
Yeah.
So one thing that people tend to miss, especially if they're from out of the area, is knowing ahead of time what frequency works and programming it into your radio.
Yeah.
Knowing that it's GMRS 18 mm-hmm. and tone 18, and knowing that what the ham radio frequencies are and putting them in your radio,
yeah.
and having your APRS set up
yeah.
so that people know exactly where you are.
Yeah. That's a good point too. What about some other things that we can do with electronic devices, such as knowing where you're going while you're on the trail? So mapping stuff.
Now, I don't mm-hmm. carry paper maps anymore at all.
Yeah.
If I'm in an area that I'm unfamiliar with, I will carry a tablet with GPX tracks.
Okay.
And GPX tracks are becoming more and more common, and they're mm-hmm. more and more in use. There's lots of programs that use GPX tracks. I think the two most common that I think about are Onyx and Gaia.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I personally use Gaia, I think, mm-hmm. because that's what I started on and that's what the people I wheel with mm-hmm. use. But I think that they're both viable, and I know that Onyx has been a huge supporter of the OHV world,
yeah.
and even sells a OHV package that's designed for off-highway vehicle use, and I'm applaud that as well. I think that's fantastic.
That's really cool.
As a matter of fact, Onyx mapped the Rubicon Trail, and that track is in their maps.
Oh, that's cool. So
it's
so
it's built into their maps. That's an advantage over Gaia. Gaia yeah. has no maps built in.
Yeah. They have no tracks built in.
I should say no tracks
yes.
built in.
Yeah. yeah. I like it. The big deal for me is being able to just overlay a track, mm-hmm. overlay where the trail is, so you're staying on the trail, over a map of some sort, and knowing where you are at all times.
I agree.
As long as the software does that, awesome. Use whatever works for you. But yeah, Onyx has been doing some really cool stuff in the OHV community. They've been doing some cool stuff with Rubicon Trail Foundation recently.
Mm-hmm.
Their map that is in their system shows where all the restrooms are on the trail too, which could be a big benefit for people out there. So yeah, great stuff. Some other software out there is Avenza.
Avenza is very good.
Avenza is very good. All the Forest Service maps are out there on Avenza. Cartatrax uses Avenza for mm-hmm. their maps to overlay into.
And Jake's a great guy. He really,
Jake's awesome.
Really does an accurate job mm-hmm. of his maps are more accurate than anybody's I've seen,
mm-hmm.
and he supports the OHV community.
Yeah, awesome company there. Let's see. Another one that I use a lot that I found that a lot of people don't is Google Maps. You can download Google Maps offline.
Mm-hmm.
And where that comes into benefit to me is typically the trailheads. You can get to the trailheads via Google Maps very well. Google doesn't always necessarily know where the trail goes from there.
Mm-hmm.
But they know where the trailheads are. And a lot of times, though, trailheads are not within cell service.
Mm-hmm.
And so I use a combination of Gaia once I'm on the trail, because I really like forest service maps. And I use Google to get
to and from
the trail.
That makes sense.
And you can download everything. I download the entire state of California in 8 segments, and it takes 2.5 gigs.
Which is not much these days.
Not much compared to the 120, 256 gigs that your phone can hold now.
Yeah.
So, awesome little insurance policy to get to and from the trails just fine.
And it's super important to think about that stuff before you go.
Yes.
And have it downloaded and know it's going to work.
Yes. Because you can't download it once you're out there without cell service.
Unless you carry a Starlink around.
Well, who would do that?
I don't know.
So cool. A bunch of different options for maps, bunch of different options for GPX files,
mm-hmm.
and being able to find something that works for you to be able to take those GPX files and upload them into your software. That's what it's all about.
Yep.
And doing that before you leave on your trip.
Before you leave.
Yes. Another thing that I think is super important when getting ready to go on a trip, preparing for the trip, is we're going out winter wheeling. I love snow wheeling. Part of the reason why I love snow wheeling is the challenge of it.
Agreed.
It is very challenging. You've got a lot of different snow conditions. And there's some days when it just doesn't, it's not going to happen. But in order for that to be part of my play while I'm going out snow wheeling, I have to mentally prepare for that.
I agree 100%. Too many people decide they're going to go snow wheeling. They take days off work. They drive a long way and mm-hmm. they get there. And they're determined to make it happen that day. And in snow, sometimes it doesn't happen. Yeah. Sometimes you're driving on 10 feet of sugar.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't work.
Yeah.
And your very best option is to turn around and enjoy a view of your living room.
Yeah. Yep. I think that's a really good thing to kind of think about is you have to prepare yourself mentally
mm-hmm.
for winter wheeling, especially up here in the High Sierras, up here at the Rubicon. You have to prepare yourself mentally and be flexible with your travel and your trip plans.
Agreed.
Yeah.
While we're on that subject,
uh-huh.
the other thing to think about before you go is who you're going with.
Oh, that's a good one.
And I'm not maligning anybody in particular. I'm saying choose a group that thinks like you do
mm-hmm.
and works like you do and prepares like you do mm-hmm. and has a rig like you have, and then you're setting yourself and them up for success.
Yeah.
If you wander away from that, and I'm not saying you can never wheel with somebody who has something, I'm saying if you wander away from that when you're snow wheeling, you're going to find yourself either they're spending their whole time moving you mm-hmm. or you're spending your whole time moving them
mm-hmm.
and in a survival situation it can be bad. It's not optimal.
Yeah. That's a really good point. So choose your friends wisely.
Yes.
I like it. Any other things that we can do to prepare for a trip? Check the weather.
That's a big one. So let's talk about the weather.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite web-based weather app that you use or a weather website?
I just look up weather.com usually.
Okay. So I've used a lot of them. Mm-hmm. And my favorite is Weather Underground. And if
okay.
you go to Weather Underground and click the 10-day,
uh-huh.
it gets technical, but if you click the 10-day, you can see 10 days out in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
You can see what hour on what day it's going to snow, what hour on what day it's going to rain at a mm-hmm. particular elevation. You can see wind. You can see accumulation. You can see all that stuff.
Yeah.
So when is the worst time to go snow wheeling?
Right before a big blizzard.
Okay. So you don't want to trap yourself in a blizzard.
Trap yourself in a blizzard. That could be one part
of
it.
Because if you easily wheel in on 10 feet of compact snow, the 4 feet of fluff on top of it is going to prevent you from having a viable exit strategy.
That's a great point. Yeah. You were talking about another weather situation earlier.
I think the worst time to go snow wheeling is a Pineapple Express. When the weather gets warm and the rain comes down,
uh-huh.
the top layer of snow gets wet and slushy and prevents you from having good traction.
Mm-hmm.
And any place that collects water in the summertime will collect water in the wintertime, and you'll find yourself driving in a really, really rigid Slurpee, uh-huh. and forward progress is miserable. You'll be slogging through a Slurpee to get to a winch point on multiple occasions,
yeah.
and it'll turn a fun trip into a survival situation.
Yeah.
It's absolutely the worst time to go wheeling.
There's I think we have a video about that where one guy did just that. He went out and it was slushy city, and he ended up turning a fun afternoon half day wheeling trip into a multi-day survival excursion.
Yep, and we will interview him later as part of the series, and that's a great point.
Yeah. One thing that, as we were talking, I just realized that Gaia introduced recently is you can drop a pin on Gaia and it will give you the weather situation.
So a spot weather forecast.
A spot weather forecast. And then you can click on that and it'll give you the 10-day out, and it uses open snow, which is what a lot of the snowmobilers use,
yep.
and ski resorts,
yep.
use it a lot to check snow loads on different areas. So. Really cool feature.
I didn't know that
they just introduced lately.
That's fantastic.
So, yeah, lots of cool things we can do to prepare for a trip. I think there's a lot of cool ideas here. I've learned a couple again. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
What do you guys have? That's what I want to know. We want more information out there, more ideas. The more that we can get out there for everybody, the more we can get educated, the more we can come out and enjoy these beautiful Sierras during the wintertime safely. And that's the key important part. How do we come out here, have a lot of fun with our winter recreation, but still make it home to our loved ones afterwards? So drop those comments, those ideas down in the comments below. Love to hear from you guys. And if you want to hear any other ideas, any other topics like recovery equipment out here, survival gear out here, we got lots of other videos over on Rubicon Trail Foundation's YouTube page. With that, I'm Tyler.
I'm John.
And stay safe, everybody out there, and keep wheeling.